With the advancements in the field of machine learning and artificial intelligence, it has become very important to understand the fundamentals behind such technologies. Hi all, I'm Zulekha from Edureka, and I welcome you to this session on principal component analysis. Now, in this session, you'll understand the concepts behind dimensionality reduction and how it can be used to deal with high dimensional data. Now, before we move any further, let's take a look at the agenda for today. We're going to start this session by understanding the need for principal component analysis. Followed by this, we'll see what exactly PCA is, and then we'll move on and discuss the step-by-step computation of principal component analysis. Right? We'll end the session by looking at a practical demonstration of how PCA can be used with Python. Now, before we get started with the session, make sure you subscribe to Edureka YouTube channel in order to stay updated about the most trending technologies. So let's get started with our first topic, which is the need for principal component analysis. Now, machine learning in general works wonders when you provide a data set which is large and which is more informative, right? Usually, it's said that having a good amount of data lets you build a better predictive model because you have more data to train the machine with. But however, using a large data set has its own pitfalls. The biggest pitfall is the curse of dimensionality. Now, in order to understand what exactly curse of dimensionality means, let's take a look at a small example. Now, look at the figure on the screen. So, consider a line of 100 yards, and let's say that you have dropped a coin somewhere on this line. Now, it's very easy and it's very convenient for you to find the coin by simply walking on the line. Right? This very line is a single dimensional entity. Now, in the second image, you can see that there is a square of, of side 100 yards. Now, again, you've dropped a coin somewhere in between. Now, it's quite evident that you're going to take more time to find the coin within that square as compared to the previous scenario because the square is a two-dimensional entity, right? Now, let's go one step further and let's consider a cube of side 100 yards. So, again, let's assume that you dropped a coin somewhere in between this cube. So, obviously, it's going to be more difficult for you to find the coin this time, right? Because a cube is a three-dimensional entity. So as you can observe, the complexity is increasing as the dimension of the whole plane is increasing. And in real life, the high-dimensional data that we're talking about has thousands of dimensions that make it very, very complex to handle and process, right? The high-dimensional data can be easily found in use cases like image processing, in natural language processing, image translation, and so on. So this is exactly what the curse of dimensionality means. So to get rid of this curse, we came up with a process called dimensionality reduction. Now, dimensionality reduction techniques can be used to filter only a limited number of significant features which are needed for training your model or your predictive model or your machine learning model. And this is exactly where principal component analysis comes into the picture. So now let's move on and discuss what exactly principal component analysis is. So principal component analysis, also known as PCA, is a dimensionality reduction technique that lets you identify correlations and patterns in a data set so that it can be transformed into another data set which has lower dimensions. And it also makes sure that you're not losing much information when you're transferring your data from high dimension to low dimension. Now, the main idea behind PCA is to figure out patterns and correlations among different features in your data set. So why do we do that? Why do we have to find correlations among different features? So the reason why we're finding highly correlated features is because highly correlated independent features usually cause an output which is very biased, right? And if two features within a data set are highly correlated, and I'm talking about two independent features, or you can say two predictor features. Now, if two predictor features in your data set are highly correlated, then your output is going to be highly biased on those two features. Also, these features are just redundant features because they do not account to your final output. So you need to make sure you remove all inconsistencies in your data. You have to remove redundant data. And like I mentioned, highly correlated features. So that's how dimensionality reduction is done in the most basic way possible. You remove data that is not essential. You only keep data which is very significant for predicting your output. Like you can see in the image, let's say in the original data set, we have like 100 variables. And then you just narrow it down to a couple of, let's say, 20 variables. This is exactly how dimensionality reduction is done. Now, one thing you need to keep in mind is when you're performing dimensionality reduction using PCA or any other method for that matter, you have to make sure that you perform this whole process in such a way that the significant data is still retained in your new data set. Right? So basically, you're narrowing down a couple of variables from your original data set to your final data set, the data set that is reduced. Now, you need to make sure that all the data that you have in the final or in the reduced data set contains all the important or the significant features. You shouldn't lose out on important information while you're performing dimensionality reduction. So guys, such a process is very important in solving complex data-driven problems which involve the use of very high-dimensional data sets. So PCA basically can be achieved through a series of steps. So let's go ahead and discuss these steps from end to end. Now, let me tell you that PCA is actually a very simple concept. You know, it's purely logical. You can totally understand it through step by step. And PCA is implemented in majority of your machine learning algorithms, and especially in machine learning, because machine learning has a limitation that it cannot process or it cannot handle data of high dimension. So that's when PCA comes into the spotlight. You need to have a method which will help you implement machine learning. Right? So PCA is one of those methods which will help you reduce the dimensions of data so that you can implement machine learning and predictive modeling and all of those concepts in order to derive a solution or to solve a problem. So let's understand the step-by-step analysis of PCA. So you always start by standardization of the data, right? This is followed by computing matrix known as the covariance matrix. Now guys, don't worry, I'll be discussing each of these steps in the upcoming slides. I'm just giving you a brief overview of all the steps that are involved. Followed by this, you'll calculate what is known as the eigenvectors and the eigenvalues. Now, I'm sure all of you would have come across these mathematical concepts. These are all simple concepts that we learned in college and school, right? Next, you'll compute the principal components, followed by which you'll finally reduce the dimension of your data set, depending on all the features that you obtain or the principal components that you obtain. Now, let's understand each of these steps in a more detailed manner. So what exactly do you mean by standardization of a data set? Okay, if you're familiar with data analysis and with data processing, you know that missing out on standardization will probably result in a biased outcome, meaning that your output will not be accurate if you do not perform standardization. So standardization is all about scaling your data in such a way that all the variables and all the features in your data lie within the similar range. So consider an example. Let's say that we have two variables, like you can see on your screen. There's a rating and there's number of downloads. Okay, these are all, let's say, ratings of a movie between 0 and 5 and the number of downloads that movie has got on some website. Okay, let's say that value ranges between 100 and 5,000. Now, in such a scenario, it's very obvious that the output which is calculated by using these two variables is going to be biased because the variables with a larger range will have a more obvious impact on the output. Obviously, the number of downloads will have a larger impact on the output because these numbers are higher than the ratings. Even though ratings is a variable that just ranges between 0 and 5, but the number of downloads has such a higher value, so the impact of this variable will be higher on your output. That's why standardization or standardizing the data into a comparable range is very important, right? So what you do is you narrow down ratings and number of downloads into a similar range in decimal points or in single digits. So how do you perform standardization? You basically take the value of your variable, you subtract it with the mean, and then you divide it by your standard deviation. That's exactly how you perform standardization. It's a simple mathematical process, that's all. So you need to make sure you perform standardization, because if you do not do that, then your output is going to be very biased. If you've gone through a couple of videos on machine learning and a couple of videos on predictive modeling or deep learning for that fact, you know that when you get your data set, you perform standardization before you perform any sort of data processing or EDA, right? Because it's important to level down all your variables in one range, right? Only then you can use them to predict your output. So after you perform standardization, all your variables are scaled across a standard and a comparable scale. So our next step will be computing the covariance matrix. So guys, covariance matrix is something that we learned in, I think I learned it around when I was in 10th standard, I'm not sure. So like I mentioned earlier, PCA helps you to identify the correlation and the dependencies among the features in a data set. right? Because it's important to understand variables which are heavily correlated or, you know, heavily dependent on each other so that you can get rid of them. Unless these two variables are your predictor variable and your target variable, right? There obviously has to be a dependency between your target variable and your predictor variable. But if the other features or if the other predictor variables in your data set are highly dependent on each other, then your output is going to be biased again. So PCA basically helps you identify this correlation between your different predictor variables or your different features in the data set. So what a covariance matrix does is a covariance matrix will represent the correlation between the different variables in a data set. So like I said, it's very important to find these variables because they contain biased and redundant information, which will reduce your overall performance of the model. So mathematically, a covariance matrix is a P into P matrix, where P basically represents the dimensions of the data set. So if you have 10 features in your data, that means that your matrix will be a 10 into 10 cross matrix. So each entry in your matrix will represent the covariance of the corresponding variables. So consider a case where we have a two-dimensional data set, meaning that there are two variables in your data set, variable A and variable B. So your covariance matrix is a 2 cross 2 matrix, like shown in this image. So here what happens is covariance of A, A will represent the covariance of a variable with itself. Now, this is nothing but the variance of the variable A itself. Now, covariance of A, B will represent the covariance of the variable A with respect to the variable B. And because the covariance is commutative, covariance of A, B will be equal to covariance of B, A. Now, there are three important keys or three important takeaways from your covariance matrix. First is that the covariance value denotes how codependent two variables are with respect to each other. Now, if the covariance value, let's say a covariance of A, A is minus 2. So if the covariance value is negative, it denotes that the respective variables are indirectly proportional to each other, meaning that A and B are indirectly proportional. So if A increases, B decreases. If B increases, A decreases. They are indirectly proportional. Similarly, if value of covariance B, A is plus 3 or is 3, this denotes a directly proportional relationship between B and A, right? Meaning that if A increases, B will also increase simultaneously. So these are a few key takeaways from covariance matrix. Now let's move on and look at the next step, which is calculating your eigenvectors and eigenvalues. Now, guys, eigenvectors and eigenvalues are the mathematical construct that must be computed from your covariance matrix. Now, the reason why you need eigenvectors and eigenvalues is so that you can determine the principal components of your data set. Now, at this point, you must be wondering what exactly a principal component is, right? So simply put, principal components are the new set of variables that are obtained from your initial set of variables. So basically, they are computed in such a manner that the newly obtained variables are highly significant and independent of each other. Now, this is something that's very important. So principal components are basically the new features that you'll obtain after you perform dimensionality reduction, after you basically go through the process of reducing, cutting down your variables. So very important that these principal components have to be highly significant for predicting your output. And they also have to be independent of each other. Now, the principal components, what they do is they compress and they possess most of the useful information that is actually scattered among all the different variables. So initially, let's say you had 50 variables and then you formed 5 principal components out of these 50 variables. Now, what this means is all the data that was scattered around these 50 variables or that was, you know, put into these 50 variables can be easily represented with just 5 variables, which are known as your principal components. So what you're going to do is you're going to make sure you narrow down the principal components in such a way that you're not losing out on important information. Right now, not all information is usually important when you're computing on your or you're forming a predictive model. Some information can be ignored because having extra redundant information will only increase the complexity of your model. And basically, it'll result in your lower accuracy, right? Your overall performance will be reduced because you're performing unnecessary computation, which might, you know, affect your final output. So that's why you need to make sure that your principal components have all the essential data in them. So if your data set has 5 dimensions, then you have to form 5 principal components. So initially, you'll have to start by forming the same number of principal components as the number of dimensions that are there in your data set. So what you'll do here is the first principal component that you form, it has to be formulated in such a way that it stores the maximum possible information. And similarly, the second principal component, which is basically represented by PC2. PC1 represents your first principal component. PC2 represents your second principal component. So the second principal component that you compute, it should store the remaining maximum information in your data, and so on. Principal component 3 will be the third most significant variable. Principal component 4 will be the fourth most significant variable, and so on. So you need to compute them in such a way that your first principal component will have the maximum information, the second will have the second maximum information, and so on. So when you do this, you know that if you arrange your data or if you arrange these values in descending order, you know that the first few principal components are the most important, and you can just take them and use them as your new data variables. Now, where exactly do eigenvectors fall into this whole process? I'm assuming that you have a basic understanding of eigenvectors and eigenvalues. Now, we know that these two algebraic formulations, they are always computed as a pair. That is, basically for every eigenvector, there is an eigenvalue. The dimensions in the data will tell you how many eigenvectors you need to calculate. Okay, let's say that you have a two-dimensional data set. For that, you'll have to compute two eigenvectors, right, and their respective eigenvalues. Now, the idea behind eigenvectors is to use the covariance matrix to understand where in the data there is the most amount of variance, right? Because the covariance matrix gives you the variance, overall variance among different variables and your overall variance in your data, the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors are basically used to understand variance in your data set. Because more variance in the data will basically denote more information about the data. So eigenvectors are basically used to identify where in your data you have the maximum variance, in which direction or in which variable or in, you know, which way do you have maximum variance in your data set? Because variance denotes more information, right? And that's exactly the point behind principal components, because you need to compute principal components that store the maximum information. Now, maximum information is stored in a place where there is maximum variance, right? That's the whole point behind eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So eigenvalues, on the other hand, will simply denote the scalar representative of your eigenvector. So basically, you need to know that eigenvectors and eigenvalues will compute the principal components of the data set. Moving on to step number 4, here you'll compute the principal components. Now, once you've finalized your eigenvectors and eigenvalues, all you have to do is you have to order them in the descending order, where the eigenvector with the highest eigenvalue is the most significant. And the one that is the most significant will form the first principal component. So in this manner, what you do is you have an ordered list wherein the first principal component is of the most importance. Right? So when you arrange them in descending order, what you can do is you can remove the lesser significant principal components in order to reduce the dimension of your data. That's as logical as it gets. This is the basic logic behind principal component analysis. Also, remember that in this step, you form a matrix known as feature matrix, which basically contains all the significant data variables or all the significant principal components that possess the maximum information about the data. This is everything that you need to know about principal components. Now, let's look at the last step. So the last step in performing PCA is to basically rearrange the original data with the final principal components, which represent the maximum and the most significant information of the data set, right? So basically, your original data set will be narrowed down to a reduced data set, which contains only the most important information. So this is the whole concept behind PCA. It's extremely simple. It's a dimensionality reduction technique that basically lets you get rid of redundant data and highly correlated data so that you can easily perform computations on your data set, because the dimensions are much lesser. When the dimensions in your data set are much lesser, it makes the job 100 times easier for you, especially when you're dealing with very large data sets, right? And that's usually the case in machine learning and deep learning. So all right, now let's move on to the last session, which is principal component analysis using Python. Here we'll be performing PCA by using Python, and if you're not familiar with Python programming language, I'll leave a couple of links in the description box. You can go through those videos and those sessions and then probably come back to this session, because you require to have understanding of Python in order to understand this. So let's look at our problem statement first of all. What we're going to do is we'll use a high-dimensional movie rating data set to illustrate how to apply principal component analysis in order to compress your data or in order to reduce the dimensions of your data. So that's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to perform step-by-step PCA on movie review data set in order to reduce the dimension of the data set. So this is what the data set looks like. It has ratings of movies that contain ratings from 700 plus users for approximately 9,000 movies. Right, so our features over here are going to be our number of movies. I think they're around, to be more specific, they're 8,900 and some digits movies. Right, so approximately 9,000 movies or 9,000 features we have. We're going to narrow them down to as less movies as possible. Right, so we're going to have lesser features. That's what we're going to do. So let's quickly open up PyCharm. I'll be using PyCharm in order to run this code. I've already typed out the code and I will briefly explain what exactly is happening in the code. We'll focus more on the output that we're going to get. So as always, you start by importing your dependencies or the libraries that you need in order to perform this, right? So we load the data and we store it here in a pandas framework, right? So our data is stored in this path. Now the data set contains, like I said, contains around 700 users for 8,913 movie ratings. Now, even though all of the features in the data set are measured on the same scale, right, they're measured from 0 to 5, your rating is measured between 0 and 5, we'll still make sure that we standardize the data by transforming it into a unit scale. So in this data set, standardization is not fully necessary because our variables have values which are of similar ranges. But otherwise, standardization is a must do step. So after this, what we're doing is here, we're just performing a little bit of data processing, right? It is necessary to transform data because PCA can only be applied on numerical data, right? All your data needs to be converted into numerical format, especially if you have data which is of characters or, you know, any other values, you have to make sure that they're converted into numeric format. Also, what I'm doing is I'm replacing all the null values and I'm converting them to zeros. So I'm just performing basic, very basic data processing over here. All right, so guys, take note of this function, standard scalar function. This is basically a function provided by sqlearn and it performs standardization. So like I said, in our data set, we don't really need to perform standardization, but it's always a plus point to, you know, perform it anyway. And because I'm showing you PCA, I'm just telling you what function you need in Python in order to perform standardization. You just have to call this function and it'll do all the processing and everything for you. Now, our next step will be to compute your covariance matrix, right? So a covariance matrix is created based on your standardized data set. So only your standardized data set will be passed to your covariance matrix. Based on the standardized data set, you'll build a covariance matrix. Right, the covariance matrix, like I said, is a representation of the variance between each features in your original data set. Right, that's exactly what we've computed here. I'll show you how the covariance looks. And this is exactly how the covariance matrix looks. So basically, each of these values denotes the variance between different variables. Right, now if you can see that some of these have a negative value. So like I said, negative covariance will basically denote that the two features are inversely dependent on each other. Right, I hope all of you can see the output. So basically the negative features, like I said, will denote that the variance or the relationship between two variables is inversely proportional. Now, once you've computed the covariance matrix, you're going to perform eigen decomposition in order to derive your eigenvalues and your eigenvectors. Right, eigenvectors and eigenvalues are found as a result of eigen decomposition. Right, this is a fancy term just used to derive your eigenvectors and eigenvalues. Now, each eigenvector, like I said, will have a corresponding eigenvalue, and the sum of the eigenvalues will represent all the variance within your entire data set. Remember that your eigenvalues basically denote the variance that is there in your data set. Right? So it's very important to compute eigenvalues and eigenvectors because they'll help you understand where in your data is the maximum variance. Hence, your maximum information will be stored wherever there is maximum variance, right? Like I said earlier, that's the logic behind this. Now, after that, what we're doing is we're just sorting out our entire eigenvalues in descending order, like I said, right? This is basically you're sorting it in a list which contains eigenvalues in the descending order. All right, after this, we have your main part, which is we're going to import the PCA function, which is there in your sqlearn library. So what we'll do here is, remember, like I said, that the first principal component will capture the most variance in your original variables, right? The second component will capture the second highest variance in your data set. That's the whole logic behind PC1, PC2. Right? For example, if you were to plot from a data set that contains two features, so let's just wait till we get the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. This is taking a little bit of time to compute. So guys, remember that your eigenvectors with the lowest eigenvalue will describe the least amount of variation that is there in the data set, meaning that these values can be dropped off, right? So you can remove these variables which have the lowest eigenvalue because they represent very little information or very little significance in the data set. Right. So after you get the ordered list of eigenvalues, you can look at a couple of, you can say that the first 15 or the first 20 or the first 50 of them are really essential. And the rest of them are not really contributing to your significance in the data set. So you can get rid of those principal components. So that's how you'll reduce your dimension in your data set. So what we're going to do first is we'll just import the PCA function, which is there in our sqlearn library. And to get a better idea of how principal components describe the variance in the data, we'll look at an explained variance ratio of the first two principal components. Of the first two principal components, I'm just printing the variance ratio. Now, if you look at the output, it shows that the first two principal components, which is PC1 and PC2, they describe approximately 14% of the variance in the data. Now, to get a better view of how each principal component explains the variance within your data, we'll create something known as a scree plot. Okay, a scree plot is, this is exactly what I've done in this set of code. Now, a scree plot is basically, it'll display the variance explained by each principal component. So if you look at the scree plot here, our scree plot shows that the first approximately 500 principal components describe most of the variation within the data or most of the information within the data. Now, this is a major reduction from the initial 8,900 or 9,000 features that we had, right? So what we did is we just narrowed down your 9,000 features to approximately 500 features. Therefore, just the first 500 or 490 eigenvectors should be used to construct the dimensions for the new feature space. So your final output or your final data set or your new data set will contain only 480 features when compared to the original data set, which contained around 9,000 features. So I hope all of you get the point. This is how we reduced your data dimension from 9,000 to just 500. That's going to reduce the complexity of the computation 100-folds, right? So guys, this is why I stress so much on PCA, because PCA is one of the most simplest dimensionality reduction techniques. And it's very essential because it makes your job 10 times simpler. You're just getting rid of unnecessary and irrelevant data so that you can focus on the more important part of your predictive modeling. You can build a better model that will give you a more accurate result. So with this, we come to the end of today's session. I hope all of you enjoyed the session. If you have any doubts, make sure you leave them in the comment section. Until next time, happy learning.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries, and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to Edureka channel to learn more. Happy learning!